Today I'm gonna do some surface on this magnificent recorder. It is a Philips N4520. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna try to do a full surface, well, at least the bits that are necessary. And I'm gonna try to do that with the surface manual. And as you can see, I have already taken off the front cover. And here we have the surface manual. And it's in Dutch, so I will translate whatever necessary. These are the technical specs. Quite impressive anyway. This is a what is what. This is an instruction of how to take the unit apart. And this is the start of the first parts to surface. This is general remarks, and here is the first interesting part. It's in Dutch and it's about the tape guides. And well, actually it says you have to check whether the tape guides are aligned and in place. So well, we're gonna do that. And of course, when we're gonna look at the guide rollers and the dish, and then we're gonna, well, actually I'm gonna take a look whether this is all necessary. These are adjustments that are made in the factory and actually never have to be, probably never have to be repeated. This one we're gonna do because that's the pinch roller. The pinch roller pressure, and yes, we're gonna measure that. The brakes, some other tape transport things, and well, we'll see that when we get there. First, the tape guides. So for that, I'm gonna have to look at this one, and well, in order to do that, as you can see, you have to put it on its back. So that's what I'm gonna do right now. Okay, the deck is on its back, and well, actually you can't have a really clear view like in the surface manual, because the big view meters are in the way, as you can see. But yeah, this will have to do. This is what we see. So now I'm gonna put some transparent tape on it. Okay, so I've loaded the transparent tape. As you can see, well, it's very good visible to the naked eye, maybe not so much to the camera, but there it is. And well, you have basically, you have to check whether this point is well positioned. And actually this is the reference point. The manual says this is a fixed point on which the entire bridge is built, probably head bridge. This is not adjustable. This one is, as you can see, there is a spring here and a nut. So this is the reference point. This should be where you base all your adjustments on. And well, so the tape is well here. I can see that the heads are also well positioned, and then you have to check the other two points. as well. And as you can see, the tape runs well. It's difficult to capture on camera, but I've checked it in real life and it's okay. So that is that. So that was that section done. And the next section is about the tape guides, the big ones and the small ones. Well, I have checked it and that's okay as well. Basically, the service manual says that it has to run freely between the two edges. There should be some space and this should of course be very tight. Well, everything is okay as far as I'm concerned. So then we have to adjust this one. I'm not sure what it's called in English, the dish, and then basically you have to mount a reel and then check if the tape is running in the middle of the reel, in the center of the reel. Well, and then you can adjust these screws here a little bit to adjust the height, the position. Okay, I'm gonna test that. Okay, so we're gonna check the reel height now. Just press play and just check if the tape is running in the center of the reel. It's of course a bit difficult with the transparent tape, and maybe it's not visible on camera, but it's okay by me. And then the other side. Doesn't touch the edges anywhere, so I think that that point is okay. So then we move on to the capstan, and with the capstan we have to check the force of, let me stop the tape, check the force of this bit that presses on the capstan, and that is, they're mentioning this piece here. This is of course the capstan, and this piece has to press with a certain force. Well, I have no idea how to check that, and I'm not going to take it apart because it's functioning perfectly. I know that when you have speed issues, when your deck is not up to speed or the speed is not constant, then this is the issue. It has to be grounded some way, and it has to, in order to achieve that, it has to have a certain force. Anyway, it's beyond the scope of this document. I've read about it, I've heard about it. Fortunately, when there's nothing wrong with it, I don't touch it. Then the pinch roller. Well, for the pinch roller, let me see. There is some adjustment necessary. Okay, so the next thing that needs to be checked is the pinch roller. And here it says that when the pinch roller is not engaged, the distance between the pinch roller and the capstan should be 14 millimeters plus or minus 1 millimeter. So I'm gonna check that with this tool. It is a bit difficult, but it will have to do. I think this is the correct distance, and well, it's 14.5 millimeters, so that's okay. Okay, so next up
is the force with which the pinch roller presses against the capstan. That should be 11 newton plus or minus half a newton, and we're measuring it like this. I've put a wire, a piece of wire on the pinch roller, and on the end of the wire I've got this digital newton meter. Actually it's a kilogram meter, and problem is that, as you can see, that the path to pull the string is not exactly clear. You have to put it in a little bit of an angle, which is not ideal, but the other option is to pull it up like this, and that is even less ideal. So I'm gonna pull it like this in the horizontal plane. I'm gonna try that. The problem is, I've already done some pre-runs of this. The problem is that when this pinch roller is released from the capstan, the tape still runs. Tape keeps on running, and that is because of the tape tension here and here is thus that the tape will continue to run in a, of course, in a slow with a slow speed, but it will still run. So it's not that the tape stops. So in the manual they say it correctly. You have to wait until the pinch roller stops turning. It's this rubber thing. And that is, of course, the one and only correct thing to test it. But, well, I cannot really show that on camera, so you have to believe me. I'm gonna try it anyway. So it's a bit difficult with one hand, but we're gonna see how far we get. Okay, so we got this in place. Another tape stops. And you can see it was 1.1 kilograms, and that happens to be 11 newton. So this is also up to par, like in the service manual, but it's best to have it checked. One thing that needs to be done is this part. It says the penetration of the belt into the bristles should be smaller than half a millimeter. And there's here a picture of it, and that is actually this bristle here and this bristle there. I have no idea what the function of that is, but well, it seems okay to me. In all the models I have seen, it's about this, so it should be okay. Okay, next item. It says when the brake magnet is not engaged, the distance A should be 9 millimeters plus or minus 3 millimeters. And there is this distance here. And that is in the deck, that is this distance here. So we're gonna measure that. Again, like before. How much is that? Oh, it's 1.2 centimeters. 1 centimeters and 0.2 millimeters. So that is 10 millimeters. So that is okay. Next up is the force needed to the force needed to take away bridge B should be 1.8 newton number B. That is this, and in the deck
that is this. Let's check that. Okay, what they are saying is this force to be able to do this should be 1.8 Newton. Well, it is inside the deck. I have no way of measuring that. I have no idea how to do that. I also haven't got a clue whether this is 1.8 Newton, but yeah, on this side it feels the same. So I'm not sure. I think I'm gonna skip that step. Next. Okay, so one thing I noticed is that this disc, it's a sort of a brake disc, can do this. And that's not good. And compare it with this one, the other one, which is functioning correctly. There is no way you can pull it out like that. So what I'm gonna do is fix this. Okay, I've fastened this brake disc and there is now very little movement, about the same as his brother on the other side, so I suppose that's okay. So check that as well, fix that as well. Up to the next. Okay, and the last check is the brake belt should be free from the pulley and be alongside the inner side of the bracelet 506. It's like this. So now it's breaking, and when, I don't know if it's visible, but now I release the brakes and you can see that the belt is on the outside. Well, it should be. On the outside of this narrow Well, anyway, I checked it left and right, and it's good enough for me. It's okay. So that was that then. Okay, the next thing is, I've done that. Next thing is the axial difference between bracelets 541 and 542 should be between 0.1 millimeters and 0.2 millimeters. And that is the actual axial difference is here. And what they mean is this and this. Well, it's tight enough for me. And you can adjust it by screwing this more tight. And the next thing is, that's important, when the magnet is not activated, 542 should be against point A, and that is here, and that is this. Well, it is okay. And then we should check spring 525 should be 10 Newton, and 525 is this spring here, so that is on the back of the machine. So I'm gonna have to turn it around again. So we're looking for spring 525, and that is that one. And I don't know if you can see it, it can be pushed, can be pinched, but very difficult. Now, so deep inside the deck, there's no way I'm gonna measure that. So I think I will take that for granted. And you have to, if it's not in, if it's not okay, you have to adjust these screws here, these nuts. So not gonna do that. Sorry, no way to check that. And then we have to check the distance between M3 and the ring. Ring 501. Now where is ring 501? That is here. The distance between M3A and ring 501 should be 0.2 or 0.4 millimeters. And that is all here. Well, shall we say that it's okay? Then there's an interesting point, it's the last point. It says play a tape, which is recorded on +3 dB, so that's fairly loud. Put it in the put it on the device and push fast forward or rewind. And then measure the output. That should be 500 millivolts. And what is that? That is that. That is for cueing on fast forwarding or rewinding. And you have, you can adjust that by adjusting the eccentric stift 548. That's on the front side. Let me turn it around for you and show you that. Okay, I hope you can see it. This is of course the front side with the record head and the playback head and the capstan. And here are the sticks that go down to take the tape off the heads while rewinding or fast forwarding. And well, actually let me put on a blank tape again so you can see that. Hold on. Okay, I've put on the, yeah, with blank tape I meant of course transparent tape. I've put on the transparent tape again, and as you can see in the default setting, nothing engaged now, the tape is pushed against the heads. So for instance, if I would run the tape like this, you would hear the sound coming from the tape. But in fast forward or rewind mode, the deck would do like this. And it will of course take the tape from the heads, tape off the head, so you don't have tape wear, head wear, and of course the sound would be incredibly loud, so nobody would like that. So all decks do a form of this. As you can see, it's very marginal. This is the playback head, it's very marginal, and you can adjust how much it is lifted from the heads by adjusting this screw, because this pylon is eccentric. So when you turn it a bit, it will push the tape more from the heads when it's engaged like this. Now it's almost completely backwards, so it's just the minimum amount that it releases the tape from the head, but it can be a lot more. So if it is too loud for my taste, then I can turn this maybe a little bit, and then there won't be so much noise coming from the speakers when you fast forward or rewind. So that was, that's what that step is for. And well, of course they have these specifications that it should be 500 millivolts, and that's all nice, but if it's too loud for you, you can just adjust that screw.
So the next item is about the tension rollers. And it says here, force necessary to keep the tension roller in the 0 degree position, it should be 1.35 newton. It should be measured at point A and can be set by changing the spring. Okay, here we have the the tension roller assembly, and as you can see, 0 degrees is totally horizontal. I checked it. You have to view this from the back of the machine and then see what it does on the front. So just trust me that it's about this one, and that this is the 0 degree position. I've checked it, double checked it, so we can measure this. It also says that we have to measure at point A. At point A, that is the axle of the roller, and just pull it up. And for that, I have this meter. Ah, there is the Newton meter, and I'm just going to have to measure 1.35 Newton. So see if I can try that. And just lift it a bit. So, yep, this is nice and horizontal. And just read the setting. What does it say? Does it say 1.3 Newton? I think it's okay. So, another setting checked. That is only the take-up tension roller. Later on we're going to do the supply tension roller, but first finish this. Okay, the next thing we have to do is connect a voltmeter between points B and C. That is at the back. Let me see where that is. Oh, that is here. It's on the circuit board somewhere. And we have to hook up the voltmeter, and in the position 25 degrees, the voltage must be 1.8 volts, minus 25 degrees should be 1.2 volts, and in the 0 degree it should be 0 volts. And to adjust it, well, some mechanical adjustments are necessary, but first gonna measure that. Okay, so I should be measuring the volt between points B and C, that is here in the drawing, but unfortunately in real life that is not so simple. I have not found any two points that could be B and C and that gave a voltage of not even anywhere near the 1.8 volts.
tried several points and just doesn't work. So I have no idea what this means and how to get it measured correctly. But if you want to adjust it, you have to adjust it by using a screw and beugel 73, that's somewhere here. Well, it's a very difficult mechanical solution anyway, so it was just to check the voltages were okay, but I have no way to do that. And actually this is the supply tension roller. It has the same, like this is the, it's almost the same with a little bit different settings, different values, but this we can measure the force to keep it in 5 degrees, 0.8 newton, and again in -10 should be 1.4 newton, and this we cannot do. It's again measure voltage, and then we can do something with the winding speed to check if at the end of the winding the tape, the lever should be at -10 degrees, and this is adjustable with resistor 308 on panel 4D, and that is 308 on panel 4D, and that is here, that hole that you see. So we can do that. So first let's check the supply reel tension roller. Okay, the supply tension roller, it's the left one, this one. The force necessary to keep it in +5 degrees should be 0.8 newton. Now, as you see, these are the indications, and you can find that at the back of the device, etched in the metal. So, +5 degrees is about just a little above horizontal. So we're going to measure that, and again you also have to measure -10, and that should be 1.4 newton. So let's try that. I've got the trusty old newton meter again. Let's see. Okay, this is about 5 degrees, I think, and I measure 1.5 newton, that it should be 0.08, and the other measurement is -10, and that should be 1.4. Well, it's the other way around. It is the other way around. Am I reading it wrong? Probably I am. Probably I am. And you know why? Because the diagram in the service manual is wrong. Because it says here +25, and here it also says +25. So what is a negative and what is a positive? See? So let's do it again. The this is about plus 5, and I measure about, let's turn the meter around because I want to read Newton scale. This is about plus 5, I think, and I measure, well, about 1.4, 1.5 Newton. That is exactly what is necessary for the minus 10. And when I go to what I think is minus 10, I read 0.7. And that is about what is necessary for the setting in plus 5 degrees. Well, what to do? Well, it feels okay. It feels just like the other one. But let me check, because I have some reference material. Here I have another one. Yeah, and here I have another one. And okay. And now let's feel this one. It feels all the same to me. So, unfortunately, this is a bit of a bummer, like the voltmeter measurement isn't working, and here the Newton meter isn't working. So I am actually not gonna check. What it says here is put a full 7-inch reel on the right part of the deck, and then put it in rewind, and put rewinding speed minimum, and at the end of the tape, the lever, the tension roller should be at minus 10, and you can adjust that with the resistor, the variable resistor. Well, sorry, but I am not going to do that. This is all too fuzzy. So this is the last of the mechanical adjustments. Winding speed, put a tape, a big tape, 26 centimeters, 10 inch, put it on winding, put it on a fast forward, and winding speed maximum. In the middle of the tape, the speed should be 6.8 meters per second, plus or minus 2.2 meters per second. And you can measure that by hooking up a frequency counter or oscilloscope to the optoprint between 0.64 and 26. Frequency of the pulse should be 680 Hz, plus or minus 20 Hz. Well, it's exactly the same value as this. So 100 Hz is 1 meter per second. Okay, anyway, the time frame of the pulse is 1.47 milliseconds, and you can adjust that with R356 on panel 4D, and that is the resistor on the front. So let's do that. Maybe that would be some fun. Okay, so I've hooked up a frequency counter and put it on winding in the middle of the tape. The frequency measured should be 680 Hz. Well, it is rewinding, fast forwarding, and it is on maximum speed. And I've got here a frequency counter, and it measures about 710. And we're still in the center, yeah. Well, it's not very close. It's very close, I mean, to 680. See? So, I think that is okay. It should be between 680 plus or minus 20. Well, it was okay. Yeah. So actually, I think that was the end of the mechanical adjustments, and these are the electrical adjustments that need to be done, but that is for video part 2, and this is the end of part 1, so I hope you will join me again for part 2.